I was 20 years old when the war broke out.
Here is the house
where I was hiding.
Most of the survivors that I know never spoke about their experience during the Holocaust.
We had to move together, and we were taken by a cattle car to the Stutthof.
Can you imagine standing squashed like sardines for 2 or 3 days?
Of 7,000 Jews from my hometown, only 1%, 70, survived. The only reunion that I can have is right here.
My mother and my brother were deported to Auschwitz, and their ashes are still here.
Avale anikan.
You cannot have hate in your heart without being hateful against yourself.
I can see kids which I cannot believe from all over the world and smiling. We have a future.
Years and years ago, I saw I cannot tell you what I saw. I'm afraid. I'm afraid that if I told you, we all would break out in tears and we would not stop. I see a young girl.
We were told all along that the Holocaust is too terrible to talk about, but it wasn't too terrible to happen. It's a period in history that I'm sure you read a lot about. So what can we do, survivors, to help you to understand it even better, if it can be understood at all? Perhaps we are the special interpreters. Perhaps through my face and through my voice, you'll be able to see the faces and voices that are no longer there. I hope you will get out of this far more than just to see the suffering and the death. It's far more important for us to study the history, what happened in Europe that prepared the climate, political, social, economic, that it was acceptable to kill people. That's the whole point of studying the Holocaust. And how short is the road from hatred to genocide?
I didn't speak for years and years and years, and I tried to stay away from anything to do with the Holocaust because my days were work and my nights were nightmares for many years.
People ask me, how do you think you survived? I survived. I don't know how I survived, but I know that
there was something somewhere along, either in me or in my culture or in my psyche, or something that helped me survive the different times of being in this horrible place. So in the Warsaw Ghetto, we knew that when you go into the place of death, there are shower heads, but they're not real. Gas comes out, and you die. So you say vidu. You have to say, and quite a few people around me were saying their prayers. Suddenly, water came out, and then as soon as the water was switched off, we were chased into along the barrack, and we were thrown. These striped pajamas, you know, these prisoners' pajamas, wooden clogs, and also a hat. And I came out alive out of that barrack, and I was looking for my father. And when I was looking for my father, I suddenly saw a man. So I remembered this man extremely well. So I went up to him, and I said to him, "Did you see my father? Where's my father?" And he didn't answer. He just looked up to the sky. And I knew then that my father had been murdered. So that was the last time I saw my father, my sister, and my mother here in this place. We were then taken to a barrack. So we were assigned and a preacher is a bunk. There were all these three tier bunks, and I was given a bunk right at the bottom, a bottom bunk, so I went to sleep. When I woke up the next morning, when they woke us up, you know, early next morning, there were three young men hanging from the rafters. So this is my kind of admission to Majdanek. This is the camp that I find most difficult to come to. I'm scared. I'm just scared, plain scared. And I haven't been able to go inside the crematorium. I went in last year for some reason. I don't know what made me do it, but I just wanted to see what happened to my loved ones. So I did go into the crematorium. It was the only time, and I'm not going to go in there again. This is where they are. I want to educate as many people as possible about the possibility of what human beings, what they can ascend to, what kind of devilry, and what's going on at this moment. What's going on since the Holocaust has happened in all parts of the world. And this is my aim. This is why I bring them here. And I show them and I say to them, this is what happened. See what the world can descend to.
I'm walking now on this death step of Mauthausen. 86 steps on the quarry. Many people die on those steps. And I am now sitting here and resting. They could not sit down. So I'm here resting in their memories.
Thank you.
In early 1944, we heard rumors that the Nazis were losing the war. It suddenly occurred to us that we had access to gunpowder in the munition factory. What an irony that would be to use the Nazis' own ammunition against them. Only four girls in the Union munition factories worked in the room where the gunpowder was handled. My sister Esther was one of them. The revolt at Crematorium 4 did occur. The workers were all killed in the fight with the Nazis, but at least they died fighting. At least they damaged the crematorium. The four girls who dared to stand against the mighty Third Reich were tortured mercilessly before they were publicly hanged here on January 5th, 1945, 13 days before the camp was evacuated before the Russians advanced. They paid for their resistance with their lives. And my sister Esther was one of them.
Thousands, and the SS cordoned off, and I think the deputy commander came in with his SS guards, and four girls were brought up, and there were four nooses hanging, and you know, at first I said, well, it's just another hanging, so, but then I saw these four girls, and when they stood up there, they were black and blue, their hands were tied, and they all stood up and proudly said two Hebrew words, Chazak ve'amatz, be strong and of good courage. And that instant, it was somehow sort of like a groan went up from these thousands of people that were scrammed in here to watch this. I remember this day because it left such a deep, it was such an anguish after, you know, seeing this, you know, it was, I said, this just cannot happen, you know, and simply them standing up there like they were truly in charge, you know, they were not beaten down, even though they were black and blue, and that was, it was sort of an awakening that here were four girls who were dying, and they were telling us to be strong and of good courage.
I was 11 years old when the war broke out. But in spite of all that, I had a pretty happy childhood. My life did not start with the Holocaust. I had loving parents and loving siblings and a loving large family. In Debrecen, where I went to school, in Debrecen was where I had my first disappointment in humanity, where our lifelong neighbors laughed at us as we were carried through the city to the deportation. In Debrecen, where I got into the cattle car with my family. And I never had a chance to say goodbye to my mother. We didn't know we had to say goodbye. And I am an old woman today. And I never made peace with the fact that I never had that last hug and kiss. They say when you listen to a witness, you become a witness too. And I'm only asking you today that nobody has to live with memories like mine ever again. Please work for Tikkun Olam.
I am writing this letter to you during the last days of my life. We are expecting death any time now. We know what kind of death to expect. My dearest, the end is bitter and tragic. I thank God for Mr. Turkin. I am sure that he and his wife will care for and will save my child's life. My dearest, I see the angel of death before me. I don't believe even a miracle can help us now. My little son Bovek and I are the last sacrificial victims. My dear ones, I write this letter with blood instead of ink. The only thing that makes it easier on my heart is knowing that Shandel will be saved. She is in good hands with good people. I can feel at this moment the pain in your heart when you read this letter. It is not our fault. We are innocent. Our future is lost. It is terrible to die when your mind knows everything that is going to happen. It hurts me terribly. It breaks my heart to have to write this letter to you. But you must know what happened to your family and how they disappeared. I am sorry to say that from the whole family, nobody is alive. We are the last. We are in danger. There is no possible way for us to live through this. We do not have our way out. We are surrounded on all sides. I cannot write anymore. I do not want to pain you. This is the last letter from me to you. Be well, your sister told me. And one day later, July 28th, Dombrova was declared Judenrein, Jew-free. And 4 days later, my mother and my brother were murdered in Birkenau.
If you stand by and do nothing, if you don't teach the past, if you don't understand how the step-by-step process took place, words that were converted to slogans, that became a national ethos, that murder became a patriotic act. Until we do something, until we scream from the top of the rafters, until we teach it in our schools, we're doomed. Hatred. We must root that out.
Max Glauben has traveled on the March of the Living 10 times, sharing his story with thousands of students. He is a survivor of the Warsaw Ghetto and the concentration camps of Majdanek, Budzin, and Flossenbürg, where much of his family perished. He was liberated on April the 23rd, 1945.
I am a strong believer that we must tell the story, but present it in a way and with emotions that will not create the same hatred that was done to us.
You cannot have hate in your heart without being hateful against yourself. And that's the worst, that's the big problem. Like when you're hateful, you become bitter, you resent everything, and that becomes part of your nature.
You don't hate the soldiers that took those kids out?
It is a difference between hating and holding them responsible. They're two different feelings. I don't have to like them, but I don't hate them, because hate will destroy the person who is doing the hating.
Basically, you know, because I'm a terrible optimist, I feel that human beings are essentially good. but they're so easily persuaded to do bad. And unless the few people who are there who say this is bad and stand up for it and do something about it, then the same thing that has happened, people say, well, this will never happen. But it will never happen only if people are there who are going to fight this.
Custom in the Jewish religion, we go out to the cemetery and find our loved one's tombstone, the metzevot, and we do what is known as kever avot. We take a small stone and we put it on the grave, on the metzeva, and we say, we're here, we haven't forgotten you. We love you. In Auschwitz, here, there are no metzevot. All those who perished here, my mother, my sister, my whole family, they have no metzeva, but you, all of you standing here, are the little stones who are saying to them, we are here. We haven't forgotten you. We love you.
The most powerful experience on the first trip was going to Treblinka. It was quite a revelation to see that 75 years after the final solution, Am Yisrael Chai. We were alive, we were there, we were walking the streets.
The children are the Renaissance. It's a rebirth. It's joy. It's peace.
Children. I couldn't believe that we achieved such a thing in our life.
Seeing all this humanity walking has made me forget that I am a survivor.
It's a tikva, hope.
This is victory, but at a very high price, but nevertheless victory.